Good afternoon, and thank you so much for joining the National Institute on Retirement Security for a webinar on a new report, Beyond the Arc, Innovative Funding Strategies from the Public Sector. Our agenda for today's webinar is as follows. We'll do logistics and introductions, an in-depth review of the research, and then we'll take your questions. In terms of logistics, we've got everyone on listen-only mode just to block out that background noise, but we do want your questions. Throughout the presentation, you can use your control panel and type any questions you have into the control panel. We'll read those questions out loud after the presentation and respond. If you have any audio or technical issues during the webinar, you can call GoToWebinar at 1-800-263-6317. We are recording this session later today. We will have a copy of this PowerPoint presentation as well as a recording of this session online. You can find it at nersonline.org/reports/ARC. Everything will be posted there. For today's session, we have two speakers. Both of our speakers are co-authors of this report. We have with us Dan Doonan, Executive Director of the National Institute on Retirement Security, as well as Tyler Bond, who is a research manager at NERS. And with that, I will turn the session over to Dan to talk about the report and start to run through the findings for us. Dan?
Thank you, Kelly. And I also wanted to thank everyone for joining us today. We're really excited about this new report, Beyond the Arc, Innovative Funding Strategies from the Public Sector. Given that we're expecting state and local budgets to be tight due to the pandemic, we are concerned about the tough decisions that lie ahead. The Great Recession certainly impacted retirement in a profound way, including pension plans, but also retirees and workers across the country. This time looks a bit different. Investment markets have been much more resilient than the labor market during 2020. But of course, job losses will affect state and local revenues, as well as the health of employers. So I'm hopeful that NERS can help inform these conversations with this report and more broadly. And I felt like it was a good place to start to take a look at some examples of funding policies that exist today. So our community is aware of what others are doing and what these policies do and do not aim to solve. These innovative but sometimes lesser known case studies extend beyond pay the ARC or annual required contribution, or the newer terms ADEC or ADC. And the examples run the gamut from full-on turnaround strategies for statewide plans to policies that were adopted to give employers a little more control and policies that protect a plan from risk posed by employer decisions. It's certainly not an exhaustive list, but I believe taken together, they do illustrate some important concepts and approaches. On our key findings, we've grouped these examples into four groups that we'll be discussing today. Liability partition, we have two examples of efforts to confront large unfunded legacy costs by using separate funding strategies for past and future costs. Then Tyler will discuss various examples of employer side accounts, programs that exist today that give employers a little more control over how costs are allocated over time. And the report also lists some key policy quotes to think about if that idea is interesting. We'll also talk about withdrawal liability policies, along with a broader set of reforms in Maine that includes one that can protect plans from external risks. And we'll wrap up with conversation about pension bonds and examples of dedicated revenues. So we start with table one that lays out some key features and accomplishments of these different efforts. You can see going down on the left side are the different examples we look at. And across the top, you see different features and accomplishments laid out. And, you know, I won't go through all these, but just to give you an example, increasing stability or predictability of costs, we consider an accomplishment, contribution rates better reflecting the value of benefits, improving contribution discipline, But there's also other things like features like utilizing partial pay-go funding. And when you look at this table or you look at the report later, keep in mind that some of these are very cut and dry. You know, you do or don't use partial pay-go funding, but others are a little bit more subjective. And I also want to mention that the green circles essentially represent a yes, whereas the half circles are a little bit more depends. So if you think about side accounts helping prevent employer exits, that really depends on the circumstances. In some states, employers cannot exit, so it may help, it may not. And that's essentially the notation there. Now, on the next slide, we'll start off with Indiana's partition of their TRF, or Teachers Retirement Fund. The TRF covers Indiana's teachers and was created in 1921. It was not combined with the Public Employees Retirement Fund, or PERF, to create NPERS until 2011. Even as late as 1995, Indiana schools were hiring new teachers that were going into a pay-go retirement system. So it had operated as a pay-go system for nearly 75 years. However, the state is rarely mentioned as a serious offender of not meeting their responsibilities regarding pension funding. And in fact, Indiana is one of only 13 states that's earned a AAA credit rating from all three major ratings agencies, including S&P, Moody's, and Fitch. So we wanted to share the story about this plan that they developed in the state legislature, along with NPERS and other in-state parties, to course correct and earn the state credibility with financial markets. So they started by creating a new tier, the TRF 96 fund, for teachers who were hired after June 30, 1995. This tier utilized the same benefit formula as the prior tier. So it was really more about creating two parallel funding strategies, giving them a chance at a fresh start for a new plan going forward. But that obviously leaves the question of how do you finance the legacy costs of the PAYGO plan. The pre-96 tier would account for the vast majority of teacher pension liabilities for decades following this reform. Their plan kept the older tier on a PAYGO basis, which is a low bar for funding purposes. However, it also called for systemically exceeding the lower standard over time. And as you can see here, you know, they created a pension stabilization fund for the legacy costs and seeded that with $425 million. The cash flow needs were mapped out, and we'll look at that in a moment. And since a tier was pay-go, investment markets really didn't have a big impact on costs. So the costs were fairly predictable because of the pay-go nature of the fund. And general fund appropriations would be made each year, which largely cover the pay-go benefits. And the pension stabilization fund would also receive lottery proceeds and 50% of state reserve balances above 10% of appropriation. So essentially in good time, resources get swept off into the PSF, and the PSF would also retain its own investment earnings. On the next slide, you'll see the cash flow mapped out. And these are essentially the cost of the plan, mostly benefit payments, and how those payments will be met. And the green represents general fund appropriations. And the blue is benefit payments coming from stabilization fund. So in the early years, it is mostly general fund appropriations with some use of the PSF. But eventually this will start to look like more of a pre-funded plan, and that's expected to happen around 2037. The PSF is, this tier is now actually about 25.7% funded. So there's already been progress towards funding the legacy costs. So it's sort of a pay-go plus plan. So in the next slide, the state is essentially slowly growing out of the consequences of being late to transition to pre-funding. Only 15% of working teachers in the state are in the pre-96 TRF plan, and less than 5% of all NPERS active members are in a pay-go tier now. So the active membership has largely transitioned over to pre-funded programs, but the liabilities change slower as many retirees are still in the prior tier. Those liabilities do seem to have peaked in 2015 at $17 billion. And since then, the liabilities have drifted down to $14.3 billion. And we should expect that trend to continue in the future. After all, when benefit payments are made, by definition, you're paying off the plan's obligations. And the pre-96 tiers benefits are finite, as we saw on the previous slide. So in short, the financing plan essentially partitioned off the legacy tier, retained lower expectations for that tier, but it did exceed in a significant and systemic way to move towards pre-funding some of those obligations. And it bought time to correct a historic mistake of being late to transition to pre-funding. And most other public pension plans in the 70s and 80s were moving towards pre-funding. So this is an example that was a bit later. But by sticking with this plan, along with other factors like the size of liabilities in relation to the economy, making contributions, the state seems to have earned credibility with external groups like ratings agencies, and it put the state on a path to full pre-funding. Next, we're going to move over and talk about Kentucky, which is another example that is looking to use a liability partition. And they're referring to it as a fixed allocation of unfunded liabilities to employers to mitigate risks. So Kentucky faced a different set of problems stemming from underfunding as well. The KERS, non-hazardous plan, has been underfunded for many years. And this left the plan with a funding ratio of only 14.2% and legacy costs that were a heavy burden relative to payroll. A few years back in 2013, the state committed to making actuarially sound contributions going forward, but the contribution rate for pensions for employers has increased to 81% of pay, with 73% of pay going towards paying off unfunded liabilities. So with costs increasing, employers began to find ways to reduce their plan payroll. And that has caused declines in overall plan payroll, which has declined by 24% over the last 10 years. So the result is employers who can game the formula by shift their legacy costs with sort of different employment policies is causing payroll to fall, and that could cause the retirement system to be forced to raise rates further, creating a vicious cycle. Making matters worse, with assets dwindling, the system couldn't continue investing with a long-term horizon. So tough investment decisions were made, and the plan adopted a more conservative discount rate of 5.25 to reflect the new investment mix. And of course, this inflated liabilities further. So in response, a proposal was developed to help address these challenges. To start, the system would determine each employer's share of unfunded liabilities as of June 30, 2019, as a fixed dollar amount. And it would require employers to pay an appropriate amount to pay off those obligations over the next three decades. Essentially, the unfunded liabilities would be partitioned off and funded separately through employers. But a traditional percent of pay funding strategy would continue to be used for future accruals. Now, this bill passed unanimously in the House earlier this year, but with the pandemic setting in, the Senate failed to pass the bill. So this is the only example we look at in the paper that hasn't really been adopted, but we believe the utility of the example is important enough to include it, and we also believe it'll get another look in 2021. So in addition to the substantial flat dollar payments, employers would contribute their share of the plan's normal cost, which would be a smaller portion of overall cost and be more reflective of the value of the benefits. And I also want to mention just a little bit of similarities and differences between Indiana and Kentucky. Both examples used a form of partitioning off liabilities, and using two different funding strategies going forward. And both examples achieved contribution rates to the pension fund that more closely reflected the cost of benefit accruals. But the big difference is that in Kentucky, they're trying to get to full funding in 30 years, so it's a little more aggressive. Whereas in Indiana, they retain the PAYGO Plus strategy, which actually buys a little bit more time overall. And on the next slide, can we move on? I think we're going to hand it over to Tyler now to talk about the next section. There we go. Okay, Tyler?
Great. Thanks, Dan. So I'm going to talk about a few different examples of employer side accounts. So I think one source of frustration that often arises, especially for local participating employers who are in a large statewide plan, is that they oftentimes have little control over contribution rates and when and how much they pay to participate in their system. And so what we've seen a few states do over the past couple of decades is establish various forms of side accounts that allow participating employers to either prepay or set aside funds for future contributions. And probably the state that has embraced this the most fully has been Oregon. The Oregon legislature first established side accounts back in 2002 for employers participating in the PERS system in Oregon, which is a very large statewide system. So for most of the time, the way this system has worked is that the extra contributions that are put into the side accounts are used to reduce future contributions by amortizing those funds over 20 years. However, in recent years, the legislature has added more flexibility so that now these side accounts can be used to reduce minimum contributions for the next 6, 10, 16, or 20 years. And the amortization is intended to be actuarially neutral. So obviously, if you opt for 20 years, the amount it's reduced in any one year is less than if you opt for 6 years, where in each year the reduction can be bigger. So this is akin to a practice that pension plans in the private sector do, which is building and utilizing a credit balance. And so this just gives employers more flexibility. You know, they can put funds in the side account when they have the revenues and then draw, and then that'll reduce their contributions in future years so that if they encounter lean years ahead, their contributions will already be lower than what they would have been. And the legislature in Oregon thinks so highly of this that not only have they added flexibility to the program, but they also established an employer incentive fund to, as the term would imply, incentivize employers to participate in the side accounts program by providing a 25% match on lump sum payments made into the side accounts. Now, this is only a limited program. It began with contributions made after June 2nd of 2018. And any employers who wanted to participate basically had to let the state know by December 1st of 2020, so just over a week ago. And they basically have to have everything worked out by the middle of next year in terms of the contributions being made and all that being done. But to this point, the state has made over $64 million in matching contributions, and the program in total has brought over $540 million into PERS, money that wouldn't have been, wouldn't necessarily have been contributed to the system otherwise. And a final thing to note about Oregon's program is that the money is managed by PERS. So it's invested along with other system assets, but it's not used when the actuaries calculate the, you know, actuarial value of assets and the funded status of the plan. So even though they're invested with the assets, they're not considered fully part of the plan's assets until they're moved over from the side account into the main fund for PERS. So on the next slide, we look at a few other examples from other states. So California, in this was legislation passed in 2018. This program started in 2019. It's called the California Employers Pension Prefunding Trust. And so basically what employers can do is they can prepay CalPERS, and the funds are deposited into a Section 115 trust that CalPERS administers. However, unlike Oregon, these funds, prepaid funds, are not used, are not amortized over a certain period of time to reduce future contributions. Instead, the employers have flexibility regarding when to use these funds to reduce their pension contributions. So they could contribute to this trust for several years, not use any of the monies that they've prepaid, but then, you know, in a year perhaps where their revenues are down, they could draw on what they've already contributed to reduce their contributions in that year. Also, unlike in Oregon, the monies deposited in this trust are not commingled with other assets in the plan. So they're kept separate, even though they are still administered by CalPERS. And a final interesting thing to note about the program in California is that CalPERS will offer this service to all jurisdictions, not just those that participate in CalPERS. So in theory, an employer who participates in a local or county or another statewide pension plan in California could still prepay funds into this trust administered by CalPERS, but use that to fund future contributions to another system. And previously, California had already offered a similar program for retiree health care, so they had some experience with a program like this already. Now in New York, this is even farther removed from Oregon does their program, because in New York, the reserve funds are not managed by the public pension plans. So jurisdictions that participate in either the employees' retirement system or the teachers' retirement system can establish reserve funds in which they can contribute money to help stabilize their pension costs in the future, but they are required to set up, fund, and manage these accounts by themselves. So they do have a lot of flexibility about when and how to use these funds, but they also have the burden of managing them themselves. Additionally, there are limitations placed on these reserve funds. They can contribute up to 2% of an employee's salary in a given year, and the total amount in the reserve fund cannot exceed 10% of payroll. So there are some limitations. There's more of a burden on the jurisdiction to do the administrative work themselves, but it does also offer a high degree of flexibility for when to use these funds. And so one thing that, you know, I think we want to consider about these side accounts is that they could be used in a countercyclical manner. So in a year where your revenues are up and you can, you know, prepay contributions or put aside extra funds into one of these trusts or reserve funds, and then in a year where revenues are down, you could draw upon that to help make up for that shortfall in revenue. A small employer could use this in a countercyclical fashion to the economy. And so I think that's a really strong potential benefit of these side accounts. And then the last example we want to talk about here is in Pennsylvania, the state employees retirement system has a ongoing program at the moment to allow participating employers to prepay a significant chunk of their unfunded liabilities. So it has to be a one-time lump sum of either 75% or 100% of that employer's unfunded liabilities in Pennsylvania SERS. Most of the participating employers are not allowed to use pension obligation bonds in order to make that lump sum payment. However, Pennsylvania State University, which is one of the largest employers that has taken advantage of this, they were allowed to use a pension obligation bond in order to make their lump sum payment. And then similar to the Oregon Employer Incentive Fund, this is also a time-limited program. So any employer who wants to do this has to reach an agreement with SERS by December of 2024, and they have to make the lump sum payment by May 1st of 2025. So within the universe of SERS employers, there's only a limited number who would be able to take advantage of this program anyways. But for those who are, this can be a way for them to reduce their, you know, pension obligations in the future by, you know, completely paying off or nearly paying off their unfunded liabilities. So with that, I'm going to pass it back over to Dan, and he's going to talk about some more examples from the report.
Thanks, Tyler. We're going to move on to Maine PERS next. In 2018, Maine passed a series of reforms to the PLD plan, the Participating Local District Plan. That particular plan was in relatively strong financial condition with a funding ratio of 86.1% on June 30, 2016. And they were using a more conservative discount rate at the time than most of their peers, which was at 6.875. And they've actually continued moving that down since. So the plan was in fairly good shape, but they noticed that financial projections showed their contribution rates could be prone to larger swings than some of their peers. And in the past, there had been changes to workers' contribution rates, retiree COLAs, and other, you know, plan benefits when costs increased significantly. So everyone was clearly impacted by this volatility, and there was concerns that employers could leave the system if rates went up too, and leave their past service costs behind for other employers to pay. So in response, there was a broad set of reforms that was agreed to by stakeholders in Maine. And I should note, after a lot of outreach and consulting with those stakeholders, they got to a place where they developed this package of reforms. And for this paper, we're largely focused on the two that were tied to funding for the plan, though we do mention some other changes, and I'll get to why in a moment. The first is adding a corridor on contribution rates, both a ceiling and a floor. And the changes standardized and formalized the cost sharing ratio. There are different tiers and different benefit options within the PLD plan. But now across all those options, employees pay 42% of costs and employers pay the other 58%. There used to be more variation there. And Maine had a strong history of solid funding practices. And I think that helped a lot in assuring stakeholders that, you know, this series of reforms they would essentially be treated fairly. The minimum rates you see on the slide there, the 42% of NC is normal cost. And that also, normal cost itself can differ by plan, but there's a cap at 9% of pay. And for employers, it's 58% of normal cost with a cap of 12.5%. And that's the most common plan where most people are in. There is some differences in the caps for the different tiers as well. But even in good times, if there is a stock market run up like we had in the 90s, normal costs will always be contributed, split between employees and employer. So the floor is there as well as the cap. There's also a new withdrawal liability policy, which was established, which would let the system recoup funds attributable to unfunded costs if employers leave. So if an employer decides to stop participating in the PLD plan, the system now has a means to collect from the employer resources to pay for the unfunded liabilities of their accruals, of their employees' accruals. This plan uses its funding assumptions to calculate the withdrawal liability. And when you combine the new limits, the caps on costs, along with the policy that prevents cost shifting, I think employers should be a lot less likely to want to leave the plan. And after all, you know, the Maine system is a very efficient system where 58% of benefit costs have been supported by investment returns and only 28% coming from employers paying into the system. So now they have a cap and there's no opportunity to shift their legacy costs. So we think that will assure the workers in the plan as well that they can be a bit more confident the pension will continue to be offered in the future. And I did want to mention that given there is a cap on contributions, you might say, well, wait a minute, if we have a bad economic event, would the plan be actuarially unsound? Some of the benefit provisions that we didn't focus on as much in the paper are designed to assure that the plan will remain actuarially sound, even if the contributions reach the cap. So the main PLD story is a good intro to talk about the next slide, where we're going to talk a little bit more about withdrawal liabilities. First up, we're going to look at NPERS. In May of 2015, they established a withdrawal liability for employers who exclude future employees. And if you're familiar with the multi-employer, the private sector multi-employer system, withdrawal liabilities is commonplace, plans have them. But it's generally for a hard freeze where everybody at that employer stops accruing benefits. The NPERS example is actually a soft freeze. So if you're participating in the plan and you say, I don't want new workers to go into it, but whoever's in there will keep accruing as long as they work, that is more of a soft freeze. And the withdrawal liability policy at NPERS actually includes the soft freeze, and the system was able to look. There started to be some concerns because some big employers had pulled away from NPERS to offer their own set of benefits. And there was some concern that by doing that, the employers who were leaving, their planned payroll would fall as new people were hired and didn't go into the plan, while overall payroll would continue to grow for the plan. And that ended up leaving a cost shift within the plan. And for employers who had recently pulled out and excluded future employees from NPERS, ended up paying the system back a total of $73 million to account and to make up for their share of liabilities. So it helped the plan sort of recoup the costs and cover the benefits it owed to the employees at those employers and make the plan a little more sustainable and protect the other employers in their system. The other example I wanted to talk about is at CalPERS. They do withdrawal liabilities a little bit different. They have a terminated agency pool that is a separate fund that pays benefits owed to workers at employers who left. So the TAP, or the terminated agency pool, manages its own money for this pool separately. And because you can't go back to the employers again later, they use a more conservative investment policy, which generally corresponds with a lower discount rate than the main ongoing CalPERS plan. So this is essentially a pool of terminated workers who are no longer accruing, and you're not going to have as long-term investment horizon, and there's no ability to go back to employers. So there's a different strategy there, and I think that raises some interesting questions that we talk about in the report on withdrawal liability policies. I think it's worth thinking about, can employers in your state implement a hard freeze or a soft freeze, or can they do either? Some states they cannot. And to think about actuarial assumptions as well, are you managing these funds separately? Are you managing like pooled into the larger fund with the other employers? And scale might be a factor there. Not every plan is the size of CalPERS. So it might not make sense if you're smaller to do that separate method. But if a more defensive approach is warranted or adopted, I think it's worth thinking about whether these funds are invested separately and whether to apply withdrawal liability to soft freezes as well as hard freezes. And on the next slide, we're going to move over to pension obligation bonds. This has often been talked about in the last 10 years. And I want to be clear at the outset, NERS doesn't support or oppose pension obligation bonds. We know there's a lot of interest around the country that sort of comes and goes in waves. We did include this in the report because we had some observations that we wanted to share, more geared towards furthering the conversation about best practices. If pension bonds are going to be issued, I think it's good that our community builds the library of thought on best practices for pension bonds. And we really focused on two areas. I know there's other areas that we didn't focus on that are important as well, but the two areas we focus on both deal with timing. The first is the repayment terms. It seems pretty clear longer periods of time correspond with less investment volatility. And we're going to talk about that on the next couple slides, but also the diversification of timing. We always talk about diversifying plan assets, but on pension bonds, pension funds typically have a pretty good dollar cost averaging system where contributions come in throughout the year, come in every year, benefits go out on a fairly stable basis. Pension bonds move retirement systems away from this a little bit because you're issuing debt at one point in time, and a lot of times those assets will be invested all at once. So we suggest in the report a couple ways to get away from the timing risk of when you might issue POBs is to issue a series of smaller POBs, maybe over a business cycle over many years, instead of one large issuance. And that probably has a little bit higher cost to do that, like administrative costs of issuing the POBs. So another option might be to invest the proceeds into equities over several years throughout the business cycle. The first idea was considered in Colorado in House Bill 1388. That passed the House but died in the Senate. But it's something that we feel is a good, healthy way of thinking about limiting downside risk in POBs. So on the next slide, we'll talk a little bit about investment returns. This is the compound annual growth rate from 1900 to 2019. And what we did is we looked at 5-year, 10, 20, and 30-year periods to look at minimum returns over a 5-year period, over a 30-year period, as well as maximum and the standard deviation as well. And what you see is over 5 years, the worst 5-year period from 1900 to 2019, you had annual loss of 11.5% over the 5 years. Now, you're probably not surprised that came around the Great Recession. But on the flip side, the best 5-year period had 29.3% returns per year as an annual growth rate. So a very, very wide range of outcomes. But as you move over to 10, 20, and 30 years, you start to see less high. The minimum is much higher, the maximum is much lower. And generally, you see more observations coming in closer to expectations. So when you think about pension bonds, you think about your borrowing costs and what your investments might yield. We generally, you know, I think there's a little bit more to pension bonds than just the arbitrage strategy. It could give you more control over how costs are timed. But we generally embrace that view of you don't want to lose money or have pension bonds, protecting from downside risk of pension bonds. So over a 30-year period, you see the standard deviation is down to 2.3%, whereas over a 10-year period, it's 5.2. So you really cut down the range of possible outcomes. And I think that's simply, a basic math concept. With more data, you get closer to averages and expectations where good years offset bad years. On the next slide, we have the outcomes over all these years, ending. The number 1970 would be the 10-year or the 30-year period ending in 1970. And as you can see, the 10-year on the blue line, the lows are pretty low. There's twice where we were below negative returns over a 10-year period. And the highs are pretty high. But again, with the 30-year, it never dropped below 5%. And actually, since 1950, it was on the prior slide, but I think it was about 8.5% was the low. In a more modern economy that excludes the Great Depression. So you do see most of these observations, if you had done a 30-year bond over these different periods, come in a little closer to what we'd expect equities to return during that time period. So that is what we have on pension bonds. And with that, I'm going to hand things back over to Tyler to finish up with dedicated revenues.
Great, thanks, Dan. So dedicated revenues is something we really saw more of following the Great Recession back in 2008-2009. We know in the immediate aftermath of the financial crisis, a lot of states cut back on their contributions for a period of time. And even though most of those contributions were eventually made up, several states have looked at different sources of dedicated revenue in order to try to relieve some of the budgetary pressures that they faced. And I think that that is going to be relevant to the discussion again, because we know state and local governments are under budgetary pressures due to the current pandemic and recession. And so one thing that's important when thinking about dedicated revenues is sports betting. So a 2018 Supreme Court decision called Murphy v. NCAA allowed legalized sports betting. And we've already seen a number of states look into using sports betting as a means of funding pension contributions or paying down unfunded liabilities within their pension systems. So Kentucky this year was considering legislation that would have dedicated 95% of the revenues from legalized sports betting to paying down liabilities in the pension system. Unfortunately, because of the pandemic and the legislative session being cut short this year, that legislation didn't advance, but I think it's very likely to come up again because it does have a fairly strong support in the legislature and the governor supports it. So I think we're likely to see that again, potentially in next year's legislative session that starts in January. Oregon in 2019 passed legislation that would dedicate sports betting revenue to paying down the liabilities in PERS. Illinois passed legislation that would increase the number of casinos statewide and would give Chicago its first casino, and the revenues from the casino in Chicago would be used to fund both police and fire pension systems in the city. And then even before the Supreme Court decision that legalized sports betting, we have seen states use revenues from casinos or state lotteries to fund pension systems. So Kansas, for several years now, has been dedicating a portion of casino revenue to fund, or I should say, to pay down liabilities in KPERS. Oklahoma uses a portion of state lottery proceeds to pay into the teachers' retirement system there. And then in New Jersey, they went even a step further. And in 2017, they transferred ownership of the state lottery to the state pension system in order to give it a source of dedicated revenue. Another thing that we've seen a few states adopt are different types of pension stabilization funds. So this is similar in concept to the side accounts, but it's done at the state level. So Louisiana, North Carolina, and Oklahoma all have different iterations of this, where surplus revenues and excess funds can be swept into these stabilization funds, and those can be used to help fund pension contributions in the future. They're akin to the rainy day funds that a number of states have. Now, we've also seen in Montana, they levy a coal severance tax, and a portion of that revenue each year goes to the Montana PERS system. And then the last example we want to talk about here is fairly unique, also the earliest one of these examples that I know of, and that's West Virginia's decision to securitize its tobacco settlement money to fund the teacher retirement system. So NERS has written a fair amount about West Virginia in the past because West Virginia closed its defined benefit plan for teachers in the early 90s. And for about a decade, new teachers in West Virginia went into a defined contribution only plan. Eventually, after studying the issue for a couple of years, the legislature decided to reopen the closed defined benefit plan, first to new hires, and then eventually they gave teachers in the defined contribution plan the option to switch into the reopen defined benefit plan, of which an overwhelming majority did. But the funded status of the teacher retirement system was fairly low. And so the state decided to securitize its money from the tobacco settlement and deposit that in the teacher retirement system, which over a 2-year period increased the funding of that plan from about 25% to about 50%. And so that really helped to kind of jumpstart the plan after it had not only been closed, but had also faced historic underfunding in the past. And so to kind of wrap up on dedicated revenues, one thing we would say is that it's important to understand the revenue stream that you're looking at. So for example, if a state were to use an excise tax, say on cigarettes, you know, if the number of people who are smoking declines over time, then that revenue source is also going to shrink over time. So when looking at these different options, it's important to think about, you know, is this likely to remain a steady source of revenue? Is it likely to grow? Is it likely to decline? And think about the long-term advantages of that before you, you know, adopt a strategy that relies on this for funding your pension plan. So I think with that, we're going to move over to questions from the audience.
Thanks, Dan and Tyler. As a reminder on the Q&A, on your control panel, there's a question box. Just go ahead and type any questions you have into the question box, and I'll read it out loud, and Dan and or Tyler can take a shot at answering the questions. The first one is regarding side accounts. What is the advantage of side accounts compared to a general rainy day fund for a local jurisdiction? Rainy day funds generally don't have restrictions and could be used to fund required payments.
Sure, I'll take that one, Kelly. So I think some of it depends on how the system works in your state. If the state is paying for the benefits, then a rainy day fund is essentially doing a very similar thing where you're putting the money on the side, you have it there for use. But with side accounts, you might have school districts or cities paying into a statewide system. And that gives local employers the ability to look at their costs, think about their costs and how they want to manage them over time. So if you have a strong economy, maybe you want to put some money aside for when the economy is not as strong. And it allows the participating employers sort of a level down from the plan or the state to essentially have the same ability as the state would have in a rainy day fund. And I would mention real quick, in the private sector, companies that offer pensions have had the ability to contribute ahead. And, you know, there's a long history there with you develop a credit balance when you contribute ahead, and that helps them manage costs over time. And I really see this as sort of a similar strategy. So the idea isn't completely new, but I think we're sort of seeing people learn from other sectors, right?
Thank you. The next question, it's a short but complicated question about Illinois. Are any of these options a route that Illinois could consider for dealing with their pension debt problems?
Sure. I'll start with that one, I guess, too. But I would want to look a lot closer at Illinois specifically. And for instance, if you see, you know, planned payroll declining and some of these things, I think I would look at some of the factors and try to get your head around what problems you're trying to solve and then start to think about each of these options specifically. And I'm not sure I know enough off the top of my head about Illinois specifically to recommend one right now, but we're always happy to have people reach out to us if you'd like to do that.
Thank you. The next question, with states and school districts already on extremely tight budgets thanks to the recession, do you see pensions being impacted at all? Do you have any suggestions on what district leaders might consider doing to guard against worsening pension debt?
Yeah, and I sort of mentioned at the outset, the pension systems, their investments didn't do very bad this year considering what we've been through. They've done pretty well, I think. If you were to say at the beginning of the year that we were going to have a pandemic, you know, major cities across the world would be shut down and most of us would be holed up in our homes for most of the year, but pension systems would have positive returns, but a little less than what they expected, I think I would have taken that. So I feel like on the investment side, the costs, especially when you smooth in the last few years, the costs probably aren't going to be that disruptive. I really think it's a revenue side issue right now, where state and local revenues are drying up. At the same time, they're being asked to take on all these responsibilities regarding the pandemic and sort of managing this in their state. So, you know, I see it as the threat coming from lower revenues, which could lead to underfunding decisions and get plans off track. And that's really my main concern right now.
Thank you. The next question, do you know what discount rate was used in Indiana to value the liabilities for employers who left the system?
Off the top of my head, I don't know what discount rate they were using at the time, but it was the plan assumption. It was their funding assumption is what was used. So they didn't choose an assumption that was more or less conservative. I believe they're just using what they use for funding.
Thank you. Our next question, do any of the withdrawal liability provisions in the states mentioned contemplate partial withdrawals, including outsourcing of personnel, furloughs, et cetera?
So not the withdrawal liability examples did not get at outsourcing. We did have the soft freeze example, which is probably the closest, but what they're doing in Kentucky by assigning a fixed cost to employers, I think that is an effort to get at more employers outsourcing work to reduce their plan payroll. So I think the fixed allocation of unfunded liabilities is really a better example for getting at that.
Great. Well, that wraps up the questions we received, Dan. So I'll turn it back to you to close us out.
Sure, thanks. I really appreciate everyone joining us today. We really hope that this report will help further the conversations that may be coming next year as we talk about pension funding and, you know, the crisis of state and local governments are facing more broadly. As I mentioned during the questions, we're always happy to have people reach out. It's a privilege to do this work and you know, be able to work on retirement security all the time. So thank you to all of our members out there. And with that, have a great day. Thanks.